Welcome to Days Gone By. Talk radio, comedy, music, interviews, and entree news streaming at you live from Miracle Island on your omelet station, WGBB AM 1240, and streaming on the internet at WGBB.com. I keep running into people who say, oh, I live in Brooklyn, oh, I live on the Upper West Side, oh, I live in Reykjavik, Iceland, can I get your show? And I'm like, yes, if your computer plays sound, if it has speakers, and if you haven't allocated all your RAM space to Japanese bondage porn, you should be able to get Days Gone By on your machine. So, if your reception sounds like an Easter bunny's been nibbling on your antenna, and you can't roll away the stone from your radio, just go to the WGBB website and click Online Radio, and for the next 57 minutes, my show you'll hear crystal clear. And it is a relief that the program can be heard outside the confines of the immediate area. Because while the show does come out of Merrick and Freeport, Long Island, and while I live on the South Shore, there's definitely a New York City component to Days Gone By. Everything from the theater reviews to the attitude of some of the folks I've interviewed, and in honor of spring and the war winding down and feeling good, knock wood, I wanted to share with you a really typical Manhattan day. It was last Saturday, not yesterday, but a week ago. And it was so typical, it was prototypical, and yet weird and paradoxical as only a New York afternoon can be. First of all, it started with rain. Bleak, sleeting, bitter rain pouring down. Thought for sure I would be stuck in Manhattan all day, just dodging puddles and sloshing around in my sneakers. Except, lo and behold, Noah put away his art, and at 11:45 a.m., damned if the sky didn't clear up, the sun didn't peek out, and the temperature just shot up to 60 degrees. So, already you get an idea of the weird extremes a typical day in New York turns out to be. So I get on the Long Island Railroad into the city to catch free shows on and off Broadway. And I love days like this, planned very tightly, full of activities, with just enough breathing room to get me from place to place without having a heart attack, missing a curtain, or starving to death. So I take the railroad in, and there's one of these guards walking up and down the cars. Not a conductor, one of these peacekeeping guys in khaki with a holstered gun. And I figure, post-9/11, post-war, guess they're everywhere. And as I'm walking to my first show from Penn Station to the West 40s, I'm seeing these guys everywhere. Not just in the light fatigues, but the ones in the berets with the real jungle gear, plus regular cops and security guards. No action, just everybody patrolling or watching their little intersections. And it should have felt reassuring, but instead it felt a little creepy. It felt like one of those Latin American oligarchies run by some general, you know? It's not like you're going to get shot if you cross your eyes the wrong way. But still, there's this constant sense of seeing people who can arrest you or kill you, watching you go from here to there. I wanted to make a phone call, and I felt weird because some uniformed guy with a rifle was standing 3 feet from the phone. And there was absolutely no reason to feel intimidated, and yet I was like, I think I'll make the call from the theater. Still, all this only bothered me subconsciously until I got to the theater, the Broadhurst, on Broadway. And I go to see Urban Cowboy, which was a bit of a topsy-turvy thing in itself, since the show was announced to close a week before. The critics chopped it into horse meat. But the producers felt it was an audience show and decided to give it a chance and keep it going for a few weeks, hoping the box office would giddy up. So I go in, and there's the obligatory guy with a flashlight saying, check your bag, please. I'm like, okay. And they always get me, probably because I carry a knapsack wherever I go, but I almost never see them checking women's purses or if a guy's wearing a heavy coat. But me, maybe because I have a beard, I look kind of Semitic, me they get. So I open the knapsack, looks inside, no problem, because I never bring a bomb to a legitimate theater. I only save them for movie theaters. No, really, take a 14-plex down to a 7-plex. I think you're doing the world a service. But anyway, I'm about to go to my seat when the guy says, front of the bag, please. Now understand, my knapsack is not huge. But okay, the inside is roomy, wide enough for a little pipe bomb or what have you. But the front pouch? I can barely fit 3 pens and a pair of sunglasses in there. And I tell him this. I said, very pithily, I admit. I said, do you really think I can fit a bomb in here? And you could tell I wasn't the first person to ride his ass. Well, maybe that day. But I was. But he just shook his head and said, look, don't give me any trouble. I'm just doing my job. And he was right. No question, I was being irritable for no good reason. Probably because seeing all those constant reminders of terrorism and armies and police forces was irking me. And I took it out on him, because here was another assault, so to speak, on my privacy. And he looked in my tiny pouch, no, that's not a metaphor, and then a second pouch, barely bigger than the first, on my bag, and he waved me on. And I was like, you want to look in my pocket? And he retorted, well, who brings luggage to a theater anyway? Now, tell me how anyone from New York could look at a mid-sized knapsack and call it luggage is beyond me. But again, I was being snarky, and it was a legitimate question, in a way. Why don't they look in pockets? A gun fits in a pocket, a switchblade, a bottle of low-cholesterol sarin. Part of the annoyance to me is that the checking is so inconsistent from person to person, theater to theater. There's no standard New York bag check. Probably be pretty tiresome if there were. I mean, this guy is giving me the once and twice and 3 times over, while in the theater next door, Abu Abbas could walk in with an elephant gun and a Zabar bag. Also, I got to the theater about 10 minutes to curtain, plenty of time. I wonder if my security guy can be that thorough with people who rush in at 5 after, which is a lesson for any potential terrorist. If you want to attack a Broadway show, make sure to wait outside till the conductor lifts his baton, then scurry in and go right past the usher. I mean, you don't want the man checking you for search. But again, it's all just a minor inconvenience, and I overreacted because of the stuff I mentioned. And it's also because the bag check happens just when you're coming from this sunny outside to this darkened theater. So you're disoriented, and you just want to find your seat. And instead of being excited and buzzed about the show, you're discombobulated, your bag's all open, you're vaguely annoyed. And suddenly all this great feeling I had about seeing a Broadway musical on a beautiful sunny day was lost in a funk. It doesn't take that much to bring me down, I admit, but I tanked a little. So I'm sitting there stewing, and out of nowhere, the woman a seat over from me asked, is this the first time you've seen Urban Cowboy? And I was like, yeah, I almost didn't get to see it, but they kept it open another week or two or more, so I ran to catch it. What about you? And she tells me it's her second time, and she loves musicals, and she likes to see shows more than once, blah, blah, blah. A homely woman, middle-aged, you could tell she was lonely and just a little bit kooky, but basically normal. And she wasn't hitting on me, she was just being a friendly person, wanting to make a conversation before the show started. And suddenly my foul mood was like, no place like New York. Like the scene in Bells Are Ringing, hello, 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 hello there. You know, stranger, pardon me, cough time. Oh, that felt good, ladies and gentlemen. Sorry. Anyway, something about Bells Are Ringing always chokes me up. Anyway, the song in there, hello, hello there, with a stranger talking to you for no reason other than not to be such a stranger anymore. Pardon me. Anyway, curtain went up. I saw the show. I liked it a lot more than I thought I would.
The story's pretty weak. But if you want to see sexy people dancing, women as well as men for once, it's a good time. So while I'm not going to say it's a great musical, or even a good one, I had a damn sight better afternoon seeing Urban Cowboy than I did watching a couple of the critically acclaimed so-called hits running nearby. But anyway, this isn't a theater review segment. Suffice it to say, I left the Broadhurst in a better mood than when I went in. I hightailed it a couple of blocks over to Theater Row, the recently rebuilt and renovated Theater Row on West 42nd Street. I was a little hungry, so I asked a hot dog vendor, how much for a franc? And he was like, $1.50, which is, for me, 25 to 50 cents too much when you're used to paying a dollar only a few streets from midtown. So I walk away and he starts calling after me, okay, $1. and I felt bad, and I was tempted, but I just felt weird about haggling, and I didn't want to seem like a cheapskate, so I made believe I didn't hear and just kept walking. Now I go catch my 5 o'clock show, Bartenders, about as low-tech and different from Urban Cowboy as you can get. It's a one-man show playing in the basement of the John Houseman Theater Complex. Almost no scenery, just a table and, appropriately enough, a bar. And it's one actor, Luis Mustillo, playing 6 different characters, all bartenders, all from different walks of life and kinds of pubs. Very energetic, often funny, not always making a point, but certainly lively enough to be worth 90 minutes of your time, or my time. I come out of the show at 6:30 and I'm thinking, beautiful, perfect New York City opportunity. I saw 2 shows, my next show isn't until 8, I'm going to go have a nice meal. Maybe a Thai place, there's so many around there, maybe something more continental American-ish. Except, as I'm walking out of the theater into the lobby, which, by the way, had a ticket taker, but no bag check, whom do I see but an old friend from years ago, when I was doing more playwriting and directing, a guy named Jamie. Turns out, he not only was in the audience for Bartenders, he's the understudy for the lead guy, Mustillo. So we stand there talking for like half an hour about how we're doing and what's been going on in his apartment and his ex-wife and my magazine and my current wife, and he introduces me to the ticket taker, who happens to be the dramaturg for a small theater company, so we shake hands. Turns out that theater company is run by another guy I used to know. Again, classic New York scenario. Biggest city in the world, smallest town on the planet. And it's up and down, down and up, from rain to sunshine, from hassles to howdy-dos, from fun flops to unknown sleepers. So now it's already after 7, and Jamie's running off to do errands. And of course I realize that, much as I enjoy catching up with him. Now my dinner plans are shot because I have less than an hour. So the choice goes from frog's legs or pad thai to pizza or boneless ribs and fried rice. But Jamie points me to a food court a few blocks up. Relatively new, 4 or 5 different restaurants in the same space, including Arthur Treacher's and a Chinese place. So I grab some chicken wings and polish them off, and I'm still hungry, so I pass a pizza place and I grab a slice, and then it's 8 o'clock, time for my last show of the day, the off-Broadway musical Zanna Don't. And as you can tell by the title, Zanna Don't, it's a pun-filled farcical little thing, basically a fantasy about an all-gay high school in some alternate universe, and the havoc that happens when 2 students realize they actually may be heterosexual. And it's very bright and sometimes witty, and the cast works really hard. I just had a tough time getting into it. The music mix was bad. Not the music, but the mix. It wasn't too loud, but the musicians were mic'd as loud as the actors, so you had to strain to make out what they were saying. And if you ever want to kill a joke or frustrate an audience, make the sound mix come out so that you can just barely keep up with the dialogue. It's a shame, because this was a cute little show for a core audience, but entertaining enough to have some wider appeal. But it should have stayed small. Zanna Don't moved from a little off-off Broadway house to the main stage at the John Houseman, and to make it fill the space, they over-mic'd it, over-directed it, over-acted it, so everything is going a little too big, a little too loud, a little too fast. Which is how you turn something delightful into something fitfully amusing, but you still keep looking at your watch. Overall, though, not a bad scorecard for the day. 3 shows, 2 thumbs up, 1 near miss, and they ran the gamut from glitzy Broadway to glitzy off-Broadway to a one-man show, all within 8 hours, all within a couple of blocks from each other. A full New York day by any standard, and I was feeling pretty good when I walked out of the theater at 9:45. So I step out onto West 42nd Street and start heading east. And behind me, I hear popping sounds, like faraway cars backfiring in unison. I pay it little mind, but it doesn't stop. So midway down the block, I turn around, and I see a giant office building about 1/2 mile away, sticking out like a sore thumb in the skyline. And behind the building, fireworks. Out of nowhere, this gorgeous fireworks display, all different colors, shimmering in the dark sky. And obviously you couldn't see through the building, but the fireworks would burst behind it, and you'd see the flashes on the sides and above it. And half the people on the street were just looking at each other with goofy expressions on their faces. And the other half, being New Yorkers, shrugged and kept walking, didn't even bother to look. What was this? Not 4th of July, not President's Day. A couple of people said, oh my God, did we win the war? Because this was just when Iraq had started moving from the battle phase to the cleanup phase. But nobody had heard any kind of big war news. It was fireworks. For no reason, as far as I know. Because they were pretty. Because winter was over, finally. Because stuff just happens in New York. And I wish I could say that was the capping moment. The cathartic final statement on an up-and-down day. One that ended in visual triumph. But of course, this is New York. So 5 minutes later, I'm walking down 30-something street, and a woman, young woman, dressed for an evening out, climbs out of an SUV and starts screaming obscenities at this guy at the wheel. Maybe her boyfriend, her husband, I don't know. But she was shrieking at him with bloody murder in her eyes. And I was like, I'm out of here. So alas, that was the capper. The yucky yin balancing the yummy yang of the Big Apple. So, of course, you can draw little life lessons from the whole gestalt of it and say, life is like that, or a career, or marriage, or a relationship. Not only does it rise and fall through the years, but you hit peaks and valleys every other hour. So just be prepared to expect both, and you should get along okay. And that's what we do here on Dave's Gone By. Peaks of amusement, valleys of bad taste, a smorgasbord so varied. Now, if you tune in at 8:45, you'll hear something very different from what we were doing at 8:10. And if you tune in at 8:46, we'll probably be doing the same thing we were doing at 8:45, only one full minute later. Yes, it's almost like magic. Anyway, last week, we celebrated the late arrival of spring and the Passover holiday. Tonight, fair's fair, this being Easter Sunday. We'll still celebrate Passover, but also do some bunny hopping, too. It'll be a theatrical show as well, as we look at the first release on CD of Jesus Christ Superstar, not the concept album or the movie soundtrack, but the original Broadway cast recording. So we'll do some comparison listening and see if the resurrection was worth it, or if old JC came DOA. All that plus the news gone by, of course, which is our weekly rundown of current events. Not only do we run them down, we back up over them and leave tire tracks. And if you've never tuned in before and have no idea what I'm talking about, stick around. It's hard to explain this show except to call it a unique mix of humor, music, serious talk, and silly talk. I don't want to describe it further because that would be pigeonholing, and I'm already in Dutch with the Audubon Society for the last few pigeons I did that to, so you'll just have to take my word for it. And who am I? I'm Dave. Dave Lefkowitz, radio personality, humorist, journalist, critic, and songwriter, and this is my show, Dave's Gone By, episode number 29, setting a good egg sample. Get it? Egg sample. Little Easter humor there. I'm not above the occasional bad pun, although that was not the bad pun of the week. That's coming up later. So it's anything for a laugh, anything for the sake of entertainment, and what better way to prove it than to begin with a man some call the greatest entertainer of them all, warbling a tune by one of the most entertaining songwriters of all. Here's Jolie, courtesy of Irving Berlin, donning his bonnet for the Easter parade.
In your Easter bonnet, with all the frills upon it, you'll be the grandest lady in the Easter parade. I'll be all in clover, and when they look you over, I'll be the proudest fellow in that Easter parade. On the avenue, I'm talking about Fifth Avenue, the photographers will snap off, and you'll find that you're in the road of gravure. Oh, I could write a sonnet about your Easter bonnet and of the girl I'm dating.
to that Easter parade.
In your Easter bonnet, with all the frills upon it,
I'll be the grandest lady in the Easter parade.
Oh, I'll be all in clover, and when they look you over,
the photographers will snap us, and you'll find that you're in the rotogravure. Could write a sonnet about that Easter bonnet and of the girl I'm taking to that Easter parade.
Hi, folks. Dave Lefkowitz here from Dave's Gone By, and I want to tell you about a product, event, or service. I'm going to talk about it for half a minute or a minute. I'm going to make it really interesting, and all my listeners are going to go, hey, maybe I'll try this product, event, or service. It's called advertising or sponsorship, and it's easy, cost-effective, and just plain effective. To get your person, place, or thing, well, not thing, promoted on Dave's Gone By and reach listeners all over Brooklyn, Queens, Long Island, and the tri-state area, just give us a call at 516-295-1511 or email us at davesgoneby@aol.com. Check our website, hometown.aol.com/Dave's Gone By, and see sponsorship opportunities, ad rates, and more. Again, the number, 516-295-1511. Insert your product, event, or service here. Sunday nights at 7, it's a new spin on old-fashioned radio when Don Lewis hosts Entertainment Long Island. It's an hour of interviews and advice about how to get started as a performer, be it as a career or a hobby. Every show has nostalgia, humor, and live music by Eddie Hug and the boys, so catch the corny jokes and talented folks on Entertainment Long Island right before Dave's Gone By. It all starts Sunday night at 7 on WGBB because the stage is a world of entertainment. Welcome back to Dave's Gone By. It's 8:25 p.m. Easter Sunday and time for the news gone by, a look at events of the past week from an aggravated perspective. We begin with State Farm Insurance Company. They've come up with a novel way to reduce fraudulent claims. They're distributing free disposable cameras to policyholders, encouraging them to keep the gadgets in their glove compartments. That way, at the scene of an accident, there's a camera handy to record the damage and the situation. State Farm does caution people not to go overboard or get too artistic with the pictures. For example, it is not a good idea to say things like, okay, Mabel, crouch a little lower, get a little closer to the guy's spleen. Oh, that's beautiful. Dab a little blood on his forehead. We need more color. What? Well, can't you push the shin bone back in? It's totally blocking the paint job. Well, in war news, a scary moment when Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld accused the makers of TVs Touched by an Angel of harboring biological weapons. He pointed to a hideous brown cloud emerging from a trailer behind the studio. Rumsfeld relaxed when he discovered it was not poison gas. It was simply actress Della Reese half an hour after eating Mexican food. Speaking of television, a landmark moment coming this Tuesday, April 22nd, on All My Children. It'll be the first time viewers will see in the history of TV soap operas an on-screen lesbian kiss. The characters are a gay teenager and her friend, who's just coming out of the closet. Whether the smooch will signal a trend is debatable, but the three networks are preparing homosexual soap operas just in case, including Gays of Our Lives, Genital Hospital, and As 10% of the World Turns. In health news, farewell to Dr. Robert C. Atkins, creator of the famous Atkins diet. The 72-year-old nutritionist suffered a heart attack last year, but his death was an accident. He sustained a brain injury from slipping and falling on an icy sidewalk. Now, Atkins' diet, which stresses low carbohydrates and high protein, is still popular. And though the AMA ridiculed Atkins 30 years ago, recent studies have shown his ideas may be more effective and healthy than naysayers gave it credit for. Still, for all his defense of the diet, Atkins did have a deathbed change of heart, and his tombstone now reads, "I gave up spaghetti carbonara for this?" Also in health news, residents of Little Rock, Arkansas got a special educational visit this week from the Colossal Colon. I'm not making this up. AP reports that a 40-foot replica of the human colon is touring through Little Rock to instruct people on the dangers of colonic cancer. Now, the Colossal Colon is designed for children and adults to crawl through, I'm reading this verbatim, and it allows visitors to see different stages of the disease, from polyps to full-blown cancer, unquote. After taking the tour from one end of the colon to the other, one of the visitors was asked what she thought. "It wasn't bad," she said, "but for some reason I feel like crap." Five orphans are suing the state of Iowa for being part of a scientific study when they were children. Back in 1939, University of Iowa scientist Wendell Johnson wanted to prove that stuttering was learned behavior rather than a genetic condition. So he took a half dozen normal-speaking kids and made them part of an experiment. He taught them to stutter, using psychological pressure and negative reinforcement. No surprise, the kids grew up with speech defects. They also suffered the disabled behavior of adult stutterers, including low self-confidence and self-esteem. Iowa University had no comment on the lawsuit. The attorney general wondered aloud whether the state could still be held liable for a 65-year-old crime. The fact that information about the crime wasn't made public until newspaper reporters uncovered it in 2001 apparently is beside the point for him. But anyway, asked about the trauma she suffered during the project, one of the two survivors told the Associated Press, "It was terrible. I am so freaked out about it. I'd love to kick that doctor in the back, and that attorney general can go fly a kite, that mother fried chicken." In Fargo-esque news, two California poultry farmers were arrested but will not be prosecuted for feeding 30,000 live chickens into a wood chipper. I like that sentence so much, I'm going to read it again. Two poultry farmers will not be prosecuted for shoving 30,000 live chickens into a wood chipper. Although the Humane Society called the act barbaric, the farmers had permission from the Department of Agriculture to mulch their stock. The birds had passed their egg-laying years, and they couldn't be used for food because the farm is under quarantine for a poultry virus. Somehow the farmers, brothers Ari and Will Wilgenberg, didn't realize that their method of euthanizing the poultry was ever so slightly cruel. Even though the livestock could not be used for food, the Wilgenbergs should still have used the standard, approved, and humane method for killing chickens, slicing off their heads and watching them run around and bleed until they go into spasm and collapse. Thank you. Alexa from the animal kingdom. Congratulations to Jake, a 3-month-old Staffordshire Bull Terrier who underwent a successful operation to remove a foreign object from his larynx. It seems the puppy was unable to curl up into a ball, so Jake's owners brought him to the veterinarian, who discovered that the dog had somehow ingested a 9-inch kitchen knife. Although the vet still doesn't know how Jake managed to swallow all 9 inches without choking, his boyfriend does. In larceny news, U.S. Marshals arrested Conrad Gallagher this week for stealing 3 paintings from the Fitzwilliam Hotel in Dublin. Gallagher worked as a chef at the hotel's restaurant and took it on the lam to America after authorities had found that he'd swiped the artworks. The shock was not so much that a chef would steal from his employer, but that an Irishman could cook. In Whatever Happened to News, remember Rodney King, the black man whose pummeling by police officers touched off the 1992 L.A. riots? He's back. Last Sunday, he was driving his SUV, weaving through traffic at 100 miles an hour, when he slammed into a utility pole and then crashed into a house. He's now in the hospital with a broken pelvis. This time, police officers didn't lay a hand on him. However, they did distribute nightsticks to all the nurses at the hospital and told them, if he's ever uncooperative at sponge bath time, you know what to do. A happy story from Newsday. Center Reach resident James Blomberg spent last week packing up his belongings for a move to Florida. His friend, Ed Watson, helped him clean out the garage and basement. He bagged all the junk and brought it to the curb for garbage pickup. Among the items he tossed, a beat-up can of liquid wrench. No big deal. Except, Blomberg remembered, a little too late, that the can had a false bottom where he stored $600 in savings. Of course, the two guys remembered this just as the garbage truck rolled away. They frantically drove through the town, tracking it down. The drivers told them to call Brookhaven Waste Management, which stopped the truck at the carting station and dumped all the contents into a landfill. Amazingly, it took the guys only 5 minutes to sort through the refuse. They found the can and the money. Ed and I both counted it 3 times, said Blomberg. It was kind of stuck together, so we had to keep licking our fingers, but it was all there. They wanted to shake the mayor's hand, but he refused. In further Long Island news, government bigwigs are cracking down on web surfing by employees of the Suffolk County Legislature. Monitoring computer usage for 7 months, the presiding officer learned that, on the one hand, the county's homepage and other Suffolk civic-related sites were one among the workers' most visited URLs. But so were ESPN, E! Online, and the Britney Zone, a fan site dedicated to Britney Spears. Though some employees have complained of a Big Brother aspect to the monitoring, executives point out workers are warned not to expect privacy when using government computers. A memo was also sent out making clear that the internet should be used only for work-related web surfing. As one worker pointed out, quote, it's not so simple. If someone checks weather.com, it could be a lawyer figuring out what to wear to court the next day. If someone reads salon.com, maybe they're looking for an article or column that could be relevant to a project. And if I sometimes look at hotwetslut.org, it's only to research the ways naked women in lascivious poses might bring revenue to Suffolk County. What? I used to work in Nassau, and Galata never had a problem with it. And what would the News Gone By be without a story from the syndicated Weird But True column published locally in the New York Post? This one's fun. A guy tried to pick up a woman at a disco in Mannheim, Germany. She wasn't interested, but as he was leaving, he whispered in her ear something about hoping they'd meet again. He also dropped something down the front of her dress. No big deal, she thought it was his phone number, until she got home and realized what had fallen into her cleavage was his false teeth. The woman was embarrassed, but relieved she didn't go home with the guy. After all, it's one thing for a cavity to burrow into your teeth, but you don't want teeth burrowing into your cavity. Yes, that's the Dave's Gone By Bad Pun of the Week, brought to you as a public service by the Dave's Gone By Radio Show. And yes, we're still making rights available for sponsorship of the Bad Pun of the Week. It's easy, it's proactive, whatever that means, and it's cheap. When you hear the comedy bell signaling a play on words so offensive, so groan-inducing, so sickening as to require punicillin, We'll also mention your company or store or service. So be part of the punderful world of Dave's Gone By. Sponsor the weekly Bad Pun of the Week. Just call 516-295-1511 to find out how. 516-295-1511. Or email davesgoneby@aol.com for the rates and opportunities. And people listening all over Long Island, all over New York, all over the country will hear an excruciatingly bad joke and think of you. The producer and host of the radio station will not be held financially, morally, or any other lee responsible for any violence, terrorism, insults, or other damage resulting from sponsoring the Dave's Gone By Bad Pun of the Week. We have great lawyers. Don't even think about it. That's 516-295-1511 or email davesgoneby@aol.com. In music news, rapper Antron Singleton, who goes under the stage name Big Lurch, had himself a big lunch a couple of weeks ago. He allegedly murdered his roommate and ate part of her lung as a way of proving he was a real badass. Police found the murdered body of a 21-year-old woman in Lurch's apartment. She had teeth marks on her face, and her lung had been ripped out of her torso and torn to pieces. Doctors examined Big Lurch and found he had both blood and flesh in his stomach, neither his own. The woman's parents are suing Lurch, as well as his label, Death Row Records, for encouraging violence. Asked to comment, label owner Suge Knight said, "Murder? Torture? Cannibalism? Oh, that is so 1995. Speaking of things carnivorous, those nutty folks at PETA, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals, have done it again. They put up a billboard in Pensacola, Florida, just in time for the Passover and Easter holidays. The ad shows Jesus Christ with an orange slice over his head instead of a halo, and the tagline reads, "Jesus was the Prince of Peas, P-E-A-S. I know, lame. PETA apparently is making the point that eating meat is cruelty to animals and Jesus wouldn't do it. Of course, Florida religious leaders find the ad distasteful, and the Associated Press quoted one rabbi as reminding PETA that Jesus was not a vegan. In fact, on Passover, he probably would have slaughtered a lamb at the temple, as was the custom back then. The rabbi might have gone further and told them that the world's most famous vegetarian was Esau, an idiot who sold his birthright for a bowl of soup. Now, if I were a marketing guru, I'd recommend Elijah the Prophet to mothers against drunk driving. After all, here's this guy wandering from Jewish home to Jewish home all Passover night. He goes in, drinks a glass of wine, sometimes a sip, sometimes all the way down. Then he staggers next door, and then the next house, and the next. And then when he's all done, how does he get home? He drives a friggin' chariot. You think one of the other angels would be a keymaster, you know? Hey, Elijah, you've been downing that Mondavi pretty good there. Sure you don't want to sleep it off? I'm fine. Just give me a Jolt Cola. I'll be right as rain. Dude, slow down. You just clipped that corner of the Fifth Nebula. You leave me alone. I'm fine. You just ran a stop cloud. No, I don't know. I think that'd make a pretty good anti-drunk driving campaign. Maybe with Homer Simpson as Elijah and the Olsen twins as a couple of moon girls decapitated by his rearview mirror. I'm digging it. In fact, I'm going to have a thick, juicy steak with bacon on the side and plan this all out. Thank you, PETA. In cultural news, 70-year-old Rod McKuen has published a new volume of verse. His book is titled A Safe Place to Land. The subtitle, Anywhere My Poetry Isn't. A little sports news. Unconfirmed reports are saying that athlete Carl Lewis failed a drug test in the lead-up to the 1988 Olympic Games in Seoul. A Canadian athlete was stripped of his gold medal in the 100-meter dash after testing positive for drugs in his system. But Lewis was allowed to compete, and he took the top slot in the same race. He also won the gold for the long jump. Lewis claims he's innocent of intentionally altering his system. His urine tested positive for steroids, but he claims to have only ingested an over-the-counter herbal supplement. I'd like to believe him, but I don't know. It was strange when he won the 100-meter dash because his biceps crossed the finish line 8 seconds before he did. Finally, great story in the New York Post. 44-year-old Albert Ermarino, by purchasing a ceramic urn for his wife's cremains and writing on it, "Bitch's ashes, Joanne."
Bermarino used to race cars at Riverhead Raceway, and the owner, Barbara Cromarty, told the Post, "He's really a nice guy. He hasn't been himself the last few years." At which point, Bermarino grabbed a cigar box and scrawled, "Whore's fingers, Barbara." And that's the news gone by for April 20th, 2003. Please send your comments, your opinions, your pieces of shining intellect to Dave's Gone By, P.O. Box 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062, or email us at davesgoneby@aol.com. We reserve the right to read your letters on the air, name withheld upon request. That's Dave's Gone By, no apostrophe, @AOL.com, or Snail Mail, Box 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062. Please, no hastily taken accident photos. I can't stand the sight of blur. Are you a member of the Rotary Club, the Hadassah, the Elks? Big deal. Why not join something really cool for a change? The Bystanders Club, the official Dave's Gone By fan club. Bystanders get a weekly special email, a bi-monthly newsletter devoted to the show, an autographed membership card eligible for discounts on show merchandise and local businesses, and a one-hour best-of audio tape with gems from the show and maybe even stuff we couldn't put on the radio. It's still just $10 to join for the newsletter, the email, the best-of audio tape. For the cost of two porno magazines, and not even good ones, you can show your support for Dave's Gone By. Just make a $10 check or money order payable to Total Theater and send it to Total Theater, Box 62, that's 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062. You can also join via PayPal, the email address davesgoneby@aol.com, davesgoneby@aol.com. We are the youth. We'll take your fascism away. We are the youth.
Hey, what are you doing?
I'm singing your theme song.
My theme song?
The opening number to your show, Joe Salzone Live.
You listen to my show? But you're a knee-jerk left-wing hippie.
I'm not. Besides, you're a puritanical right-wing kook.
Maybe true, but I listen to all viewpoints. And I do it every Saturday night at 7:30 on WGBB.
The station that serves your community. We are the youth.
Shut up.
Sorry. Welcome back to Dave's Gone By. It's 8:45 p.m., and I told you we'd be doing something different at 8:45. Time now for Dave's Gone Cultural, where we look at the arts, everything from theater to books to movies to music. Tonight, a combination of theater and music, as we check out the arrival of Jesus Christ Superstar on CD. Now, if that sounds confusing, because you already have Superstar in your CD collection, it's because you probably have the original rock opera. Remember that two-record set from 1970 in that amazing soft brown cover with the two gold angels on the front? Well, that was re-released a few years ago on the MCA label. But a couple of weeks ago, Decca Broadway, a fairly new off-spin of Universal Music, put out a one-disc release of the original Broadway cast album. See, Jesus Christ Superstar began as a song cycle, an idea by composer Andrew Lloyd Webber and lyricist Tim Rice, before it was a touring show or an extravaganza, anything like that. It was a record album. Same thing with Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. They wrote it and recorded it just as a listening experience. But then little unlicensed stagings of Superstar began sprouting all over England and Australia. And in the booklet for the re-release, Tim Rice recalled that the original record album was, quote, a dud in England. That's why when he and Webber felt it was time to stage it professionally, they chose Broadway instead of the West End. So Jesus Christ Superstar opened at Broadway's Mark Hellinger Theater in October 1971 and ran for nearly 2 years. Then, once it was a hit, they opened a production in London, and that ran more than 3,000 performances. So, is the new, very truncated version of Jesus Christ Superstar, the original Broadway cast version, worth having if you already own the song cycle. If you have neither and were choosing between the two, there's no contest. The full rock opera has much more storytelling force. There are great tunes completely left out of the new release, like Strange Thing Mystifying and The Temple. And if you happen to like Yvonne Elliman, who plays Mary Magdalene and sings the popular hit I Don't Know How to Love Him, that can go either way because she's the only cast member who's on both the original recording and in the Broadway show. But I never found her voice particularly appealing. You do get her singing, however, one song on the new release that Weber and Rice added for Broadway. It's not in the original rock opera. The director suggested they needed a soft ballad as a break between the trial scene and the crucifixion. It's a pretty song, and you may not be familiar with it. So here's Yvonne Elliman asking the question, ever so Britishly, could we start again, please? More time to play selections from both versions of Superstar, but for me, that song is the only compelling reason to buy the new old version. Now, if you're a fan of Ben Vereen, you might feel differently. He was the Broadway Judas. I think he's too apoplectic. He sings shouts too much. But Vereen's fans may prefer him to the rock opera's Murray Head. Yes, that Murray Head, who's the song cycle's Judas. He doesn't sound anything like he would years later when he had that hit with One Night in Bangkok, a tune from the Tim Rice musical, Chess. I prefer Head. No jokes, please. His version of Heaven on Their Minds is really thrilling. However, I must admit, I kind of prefer the Jesus in the Broadway version. He seems nicer, friendlier, played by a guy named Jeff Fenholt. Whereas on the original rock opera, Ian Gillan is always kvetching, always shrieking about something and haranguing people. For a guy who's supposed to be about faith and cleansing and peace, he's a real pill. It's like he's being tortured a hell of a long time before they nail him to the cross. Still, his version, the 1970 rock opera song cycle, is the one to get. The 1971 stage version, newly released on Decca Broadway, has Ben Vereen, a mellower Jesus, an equally good rendition of Herod's song, and a really nice extra tune that I just played. But I doubt it's worth the HMV price. Maybe on sale. Your call. Just ask yourself, what would Jesus do?
Broadway, off-Broadway, cabaret. These are magical words conjuring up a universe of great entertainment. If you want to know everything about what's happening on the stages of New York, you need to get Performing Arts Insider magazine. For 60 years, Performing Arts Insider has been a bible of the industry. It tells you when shows are opening and closing, what they're about, who's in it, designers, writers, composers, contacts for producers and managers, box office info, parental guides, everything you need to know if you care about theater, opera, and dance too. As the chief editor of Backstage put it, Performing Arts Insider is who, what, where, and when, all the facts at your fingertips. For more information, how to subscribe or get a sample issue, call 516-295-1511 or go to www.totaltheater.com and click on Performing Arts Insider. Do you know what Long Island is doing Friday nights? No, not that. Long Island's Dating, a show for singles by that very singular personality, Bonnie D. Graham. Bonnie talks live with callers and guests about all facets of singlehood, sex, health, relationships, and sex. Bonnie's a comedian and TV host, so whatever your habitational status, check out Long Island's Dating Friday nights at 6 on WGBB. Welcome back to the closing moments of Dave's Gone By. Man, this is one of those shows where I wish I had that extra half hour I had during the winter. So much else I wanted to do, so much more music I wanted to play, but the clock got away from me, the Easter Bunny started laying scrambled eggs, and before I knew it, it was time to wrap up the show, our 29th episode. My thanks, as always, to that goddess of the vernal equinox, station manager Joey, and my weekly Easter oyster engineer Paul. Special thanks to engineers Tom and Joe for their excellent advice, and to my wife Joyce for helping me bloom. Well, tax time is over, the war's winding down, spring is finally here. Maybe you have more free time, a little more spending money. By gosh, spend it on Dave's Gone By. $10 makes you a member of the Bystanders Club. Just $10. Cash, check, PayPal, rolls of dimes, we don't care. It gets you the newsletter, discount card, autograph, and of course, the best of audio tape. If the purse strings of your business have loosened up a bit, how about advertising on the show? Or sponsoring a segment like the News Gone By, the World Weird Web, or even, God help you, the bad pun of the week. Lots of opportunities, lots of reasons to share your company with our listeners. Call 516-295-1511 for information on advertising and sponsorship and the club, 516-295-1511. But even if you're not a joiner or an advertiser or a sponsorer, you can support the show just by sending emails and letters. Tell me what you like, tell me what you don't like, tell me what you have for breakfast. Just make that connection so I know and the station knows and the management knows that people are listening and caring. That's Dave's Gone By at AOL.com. Dave's Gone By, no apostrophe, at AOL.com. No computer? Paint it on a hard-boiled egg and roll it to Dave's Gone By, P.O. Box 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062. The phone number, address, and a whole bunch of other stuff is on the show's website, hometown.aol.com/Dave's Gone By. It's also the place where you can purchase cassettes of previous episodes, hometown.aol.com/Dave's Gone By. And if you forget the URL, just Google search Dave's Gone By, and we're right up top. And by the way, it's by B-Y, not B-Y-E, and there's no apostrophe when you're doing the URL either. Thank you, Engineer Paul. And don't forget to tell your family, friends, and enemies, even if they're not in New York, they can listen to Dave's Gone By on the internet at WGBB.com. It's amazing how being on the web has expanded our audience, and one assumes the audience for other shows on WGBB, such as Joe Salzone Live, Saturdays at 7:30, Entertainment Long Island, 7 o'clock on Sundays, right before my show. Tune in for Don Lewis at 7, and then keep it here from 8 to 9 for Dave's Gone By. Friday nights at 6, it's Long Island's Dating with Bonnie D. Graham. Sunday nights at 10, an hour from now, it's Real Time Radio, a brand new program of very listenable rap, soul, and hip-hop. And finally, give a listen to Midnight Madness, hosted by Mike Artsis. That's on at 11 tonight. He's on the station all over the place, so give all of Mike's shows a chance. And by the way, I have been on Midnight Madness for the last bunch of weeks. I might even make a cameo tonight. I don't know at this point, so you're just going to have to listen at 11 to find out. Anyway, that's Dave's Gone By for this week, April 20th, 2003. I'll be back, God willing, next Sunday night, 8 p.m. on WGBB AM 1240 and live on the net at WGBB.com. Until then, don't miss your days going by. This is Dave Lefkowitz. Good night. Set a good example. And gone by.
I will go on my way and jump the hedges first.